Welcome to the inauguration. No, I'm kidding. As you well know, this is Great Decisions. It's great to see so many familiar faces back here this year. As I always say, this is one of my favorite things that the World Affairs Council of Oregon gets to do every year, because it is the oldest grassroots global affairs program in the nation. And Portland was part and parcel of this this program even starting. Great Decisions started in Portland in 1954. Very much in a moment like one we are seeing right now. And it was a way to connect you and I and your neighbors with the issues that are changing who we are and where we're going, and a way to actually accentuate that we are citizens of a world and we cannot shut our doors and windows to that fact or reality. Are you hearing me, Washington, D.C.? As some of you probably know, we had to reschedule last week's program because of the unbelievable, devastating snow that we were given. I say that being from the Northeast and the Midwest, so there's a little bit of scoffing involved. We're rescheduling OSU's Amy Billow for March 10th. In this room, so we're just tagging it on to the end of to the series. Wanted to let you know that we are live streaming the whole series. If you've got one of these and you can't make it here, you can log on to Ustream, or you can just go to our website at worldoregon.org, and if you go to the Great Decisions page, it's up there running live, and you'll probably see me if you went there right now standing here talking to you, so it's kind of a it kind of boggles the mind. We're doing something new this year, which is we are making this program free for members. If you are not a member, we are charging $5, and that's a way to support things like being able to stream this into high school classrooms and libraries in Bend and things like that all around the state, and make what we do a little bit more Oregonian in terms of our outreach and our deployment. So we've been able to do this for free for years for folks, but you know, there is a new normal out there, and I hope you can all join us on that wave. If you need a Great Decisions book, they are $25 for members, they are $30 for the general public, and you can get them over here, you can get them in our office. If for those of you who don't know it, we're in the Oregon Historical Society, third floor. We love seeing your smiling faces, so you can always stop there and just get one here. We'll have them every single week. Other things coming up. Oh, we are doing a wonderful partnership in addition to this series, which we do with the Office of International Studies. We're doing a series with the Office of International Affairs, the Institute for Asian Studies, and the Oregon Consular Corps, and it's a multi-part series that looks at consul generals from the Pacific Rim. And we've had a few of those. The next one kicks off Tuesday, January 24th, and it will be, the series is called The World ... in General. And this is gonna feature Vincent Chin Sing Yao of the Taipei Economic and Cultural Office. So if you wanna know what's going on with the pivot towards Asia, issues around free trade, what things might look like in the next administration for relationships on either side, it's a great series. We'll be continuing it with consul generals from Japan, India, Malaysia, I think, is that it?
Singapore.
Well, actually, no, Singapore, I think we said it against. And what else? Oh, unique opportunity to activate your inner citizen diplomat. We're looking for homestays for a group of emerging leaders from Ukraine in March. We'll be here as part of a USAID training program, and it is opening your doors to an international visitor for a unique American home experience is a fantastic way to build lifelong connections and promote mutual understanding across borders, culture, and language, and there is no substitute for breaking bread with someone from another culture. So details are on our website, worldoregon.org. As many of you know, our longtime president, Maria Wolf, retired this last year, and we hired Derek Olson, formerly of Business Oregon and Greater Portland, Inc., and a former board member, as our new driving force, and I'm going to ask Derek to stand up. Thank you. I was going to say, as a way of saying, hey, let's give him a shout out. If you'll see Derek at lots of events, go up and say hi to him. He's got wonderful energy. He has ignited the office with incredible momentum and collaborative spirit, and we're humming along. Which brings me to my next point. How many of you want to know who's coming for the International Speaker Series? Well, great. I'm going to tell you in a couple weeks then. But what I will tell you is, one of the speakers we have already announced, because we're doing a partnership with OPB. So Rick Steves will be speaking on March 1st at the Schnitz. We will announce the other three speakers shortly. I guarantee you it will spin your head, it will boggle your mind, it will move your heart, and hopefully elicit a call to action from this wonderful city that knows how to do things very well, other than shovel snow. Anyway, next week we're going to have Craig Parsons from U of O here talking on the EU and the future of Europe. We had him a couple months ago for a program. He is one of the best speakers I've ever heard talk about the EU. He talks about it with the fervor and passion of, like, he's talking about his favorite band. He is like, he's a young scholar, he knows what he's doing, and I think he will totally excite you, and he also totally disagrees with the chapter in your Great Decisions book, so it'll be a good way to wrangle with some good critical information. Anyway, that brings me to today's program. We're very, very lucky to have a community partner like Mercy Corps here in our backyard. Megan McMorrin, who's sitting down here, is one of my favorite partners to co-conspire on events and ideas. And anytime we've got a good topic and I go, hey, is there someone in your office who's working in Kuala Lumpur or Afghanistan? And as it turns out, Najia Hyder is our speaker today. Najia has more than 20 years of development experience working in public and nonprofit sectors in Africa, in East, South, and Central Asia, the Balkans, the Caucasus, the Middle East, and the US, including working currently as Mercy Corps' Deputy Regional Director for Afghanistan and Pakistan. Prior to that, she worked in a number of different capacities for Mercy Corps, including Director of Global Field Programming, Director of Leadership Development as a Senior Program Officer, and acting country director for Uzbekistan. And prior to that, she was with UNICEF. She was the national coordinator for the Ministry of Women's Development, so she's got fantastic on-the-ground experience. And when we talked about during this, we talked about, do we talk about US policy? Do we talk about government relations? And I like to sometimes put a different spin on this and have someone who's got a very, very different perspective on the thematic or the idea that we're talking about in the Great Decision series. So I think that Najia's experience is going to give you a very, very different perspective on the various policy and sort of US interests in foreign policy things you'll read in the chapter. So let's give her a big hand.
Hi everyone, it's my pleasure to be part of your Great Decision series. Thank you for having me on such a memorable day in our history. Seriously, it's my pleasure to stop doing that. I am originally from Pakistan, as some of you pointed out looking at what I'm wearing. And I first arrived here and got to know the United States of America through Eugene, Oregon, if you would believe that. That was my landing spot in the USA. And I was joining the University of Oregon. And the year was 1998. It was a wonderful time. At that time, when I used to say to people I'm from Pakistan, they would look at me blankly. And sometimes I remember somebody asking me, is that in Texas? And I said, a little further south. So those now look back at them as fond memories and good times. Sadly, Pakistan's been in the news quite a bit and gained recognition, but not for great things recently. Interestingly, that's when I came and then joined Mercy Corps after graduating. And my first experience with Mercy Corps was heading out to Afghanistan for an internship. So I was in the International Studies program at the U of O and required to do an internship. And of course, looked at Mercy Corps as an international development organization. And very luckily, landed an internship that was for the programming at that time. The year was 2000. Mercy Corps was doing in Afghanistan in sight, as well as for refugees who were outside in Pakistan. And the operations were being run out from the Pakistan base, which is in Quetta, southwest of the country. You'll see it maybe in the map. And this was the time that the Taliban was in power in Afghanistan. So we had access to various locations, especially in Kandahar and Taliban heartland area and Helmand. We continued working there as Mercy Corps throughout those years that Taliban was there. So that was the first interaction with Mercy Corps. I got to learn about the organization, its amazing culture, totally hooked me, and also learned about the issues that the refugees were facing in the camps, which were in Balochistan and Pakistan, some of the biggest camps that I've been to anywhere, and also the small farmers inside of Afghanistan, what they were dealing with. This was also the time that the Taliban had put a ban on opium cultivation, if you recall from your article. So things were pretty much in flux in all kinds of different ways. I returned after the spring of 2000, completed my studies, graduated the next year, and luckily landed a job with Mercy Corps. It was focused on the Balkans, so that was my focus. The year was 2001, and September 11th happened. And as the bombing began in Afghanistan right after that, Mercy Corps deployed humanitarian efforts for those populations who were impacted by the war that had just started. And I deployed once again to Pakistan, where the operations were based out of, to support the humanitarian effort that was underway. And if you recall, this was a crazy time, right? This was when all of the airports were ramping up security in a major, major way. But it was so close to after 9/11 that they didn't have those systems in place. So here I am with my Pakistani passport arriving at the airport, and the person at the desk looks at it and was like, honey, why would you go there right now? And he was trying to convince me to change my plans. I explained, like, no, this is an organization, we're humanitarian, this is the kind of places we go to, so if there's a war, we go and try and help people. They're like, all right, don't worry, we're gonna take care of you. So they said, this person, we're gonna assign him to you. He'll go with you all the way. And just imagine, I mean, usually a sane person wouldn't ask this question, but it was so crazy. There were talks of US Marshals on flights. You would see fighter jets accompanying planes if they veered off or did something weird. So here I am, a sane person, I swear, otherwise, saying, all the way to Pakistan? And he starts laughing. I was like, no, all the way to the aircraft. I'm like, all right. So they didn't have any scanners in place. They didn't have their protocols all set up. But they said, OK, just give us everything, like from my passport to my ticket to my hand luggage to my purse. I didn't have anything in my hand. You know, they just did a search, and they were like, all right, give us everything. They hand searched all of my luggage, my checked-in luggage, my hand luggage. And then this person carried it all the way to the aircraft. I think they were trying to make sure nothing untoward got into my luggage. And I was wondering who's going to do this for the rest of the airports that I go through. But so I landed in Pakistan as part of that effort. And those were the early days. The bombing had started. This is October 2001. And what was happening to the population inside Afghanistan was that all neighboring countries had sealed their borders, for those of you who might remember that time. And they were displaced from their own communities, but they had nowhere to go. So they were amassed around these border areas. And we were spending inordinate amount of time at, we were just sort of brainstorming and how to get food and essential items and water to these people. And all kinds of ideas were being discussed. I spent a fair bit of time with the Pakistani government trying to just get no objection certificates and getting trucks of food and water in. A few months in, we had a really good team in place. We were, of course, we already had an operation ongoing, so we were also worried about our teams who were inside Afghanistan, trying to maintain some kind of contact with them, figuring out how do we continue with certain things that were non-response. And in our world, response means immediate needs, right? So you're dealing with a catastrophe that people are displaced from their communities, their networks, their markets, all of the systems that help us be leading a normal life. So that's what we were focused on at that time. once we had a good team in place, a couple of months later, returned to my job back here in Portland, which was focused, again, on the Balkans, which was the other disaster that everybody was working on at that time. So since then, I have been back, since 2001, I have been back to Afghanistan a couple different times, once in 2004, 2005. We were designing a program for adolescent girls in the north of the country. So Kunduz, those of you who read about it or may know about it otherwise, and Talokan, very, very conservative spots. When we were traveling there, I don't remember seeing any woman, even with a burqa, on the streets. So even though we were fully covered, and I was fully covered, and I looked pretty local over there, I think people were shocked just because they could sometimes see half my face. And I was like, why are... And then I was like, oh, because I'm the only woman in this entire marketplace. So yes, this is still like... Because you're like, I'm not... Like, nothing is showing. But I was like, well, I'm showing as a person underneath all of this. So... But despite all of that, the teachers at the schools we were going to be working through schools and principals were just really excited about having extracurricular activities, sports activities, and had a lot going on, interestingly. So they would do a demonstration of whatever was going on in the school at that time. And I remember going to one school and I was trying to find those photographs of girls doing Taekwondo. And not something you expect from the north of Afghanistan, which, you know, I mean... and again, different places, different kinds of things. It was just so, it busts those myths that you have about certain places. And you're like, you know, life goes on. It's slightly different, but it's super exciting. And then most recently in 2014, I was there again. But it was really April of last year in 2016 that I moved into my current role, which is supporting these two countries as a deputy director for that region. And in the past few months, I've been to Kabul a couple times and to Kandahar once. And if, from my vantage point, because I've been kind of going in and coming out at different points almost in history over these last 15, 16 years, it's remarkable how much things start shifting. So in 2004-05, there was, you know, it was right at the beginning of that period of 15 years of war that it has been through. In 2014, it was a whole new hope almost emerging, and there was so much construction going on in Kabul. You couldn't breathe. There was just so much construction going on, and it was something you noticed. And most of them around Kabul were huge wedding halls, and it seems to be quite the business to do, to create these huge wedding halls. But when you go to Kandahar, or when I went to Kandahar, that's where you feel where the economy has been hugely impacted by the withdrawal of troops. So that's where you notice massive buildings that are vacated and had international forces in there before. Markets that you see, which are ghost markets now and recently had life growing. I think in the photographs, you'll see a photograph that maybe makes no sense. It looks like a Tetris Lego set almost. What that was we were traveling outside, and it's taken from the back of a moving vehicle, so a little blurry. We were going outside of Kandahar city into the districts to some of our project sites. We were working with agriculture and farmers over there on crops like saffron and pistachio, and I'll talk about that in a minute. But on the way there, you'll see the terrain. It's just nothing. Like, there's nothing. It's arid land, barren land on both sides. Sometimes you pass by like a small building somewhere and you have no idea what that might be. And in the middle of that, there's this thing and you're looking at it and it's like, what is that? And it's containers on containers on containers. And these are containers which those of you who've traveled internationally or moved from places, you know, we use for moving personal effects, like moving your entire household, or equipment or merchandise or maybe military equipment, who knows. But there is this almost what feels like a neighborhood worth of containers just sitting there. And then you start noticing around you in the markets, especially out in the districts, the smaller markets, that what looked like, you know, is it corrugated metal that's used for, you know, just that kind of thing? But no, it's not that. It's really sawed off containers that they're sitting in as shops. And some very creative ways of using containers. Just the whole place is inundated with containers, which I think I mean, you can draw your own conclusions, but I was asking my team, I was like, what is this about? And they're like, oh, who cares? And I was like, this is one of those things where so many foreigners came in for whatever reason. Yeah, that's it. I was trying to take a photograph from the other end to see how far it goes. Like, it just goes. And some of the remnants left behind, you know, I don't know if anyone is. And other places, these get sold off as scrap metal or would be reused. But I think they have been saturated. Like, they've been used for every purpose they could think of. And then these are lying here. Maybe there's a reason I just didn't look into it too much. So those were some of the visits. Before I go into our programming, let me give you a brief overview of Mercy Corps. I assume many of you know what Mercy Corps does really, really well. But for those of you who may not have heard of it, Mercy Corps is an international humanitarian organization. We are non-governmental. We work under international humanitarian principles of humanity, impartiality, independence. We work about in 40 plus countries around the world, and a team of about 5,000 that is mostly nationals of the countries where we are working. So about 90% of that is from the places that we're operating in. So for instance, in Afghanistan, we have a team of about 200 plus, and only 6 of them are not from Afghanistan. And those of the teams which we call expatriates, not from the country where they're working, mostly come from within the region or from the broader world. We really believe that a better world is possible. We are community-driven, we are market-based, we try and work really, really closely with the communities in both identifying the issues that they're facing and identifying the solutions that are needed. We believe that we don't have to try again and again the same thing. So innovation comes from there, right? And that's at the core of our DNA, I want to say. Find new ways of solutions, find new solutions, find new ways of attacking issues. Improve little by little, working with those who are most relevant to it. We also don't, we strongly believe in this, we don't create a situation where when we leave, everything that we've created falls apart. So we connect people, we facilitate linkages with markets, with anything that should be working in that space, whether it's public service that's missing. So whatever the gaps are, we try and bridge that by bringing those people together rather than inserting ourselves into that gap. And that's the idea of when we leave, things continue to work. In Afghanistan and Pakistan, we have been working since 1986. And our work there in 1986 was working with displaced populations inside the country and with refugees in Iran, in Pakistan. We were working quite a bit with smallholder farmers and continue to do that to this day. That is the mainstay of the economy, especially in the rural parts of the country. And we have stayed quite engaged with that. For those of you who are familiar with Mercy Corps' work would know that when we're working in a place like Afghanistan, which is now almost 40 years of cycles of war and insecurity, we often are really engaged in what we call, what I was calling humanitarian response activities. So looking at immediate needs, etc. But as we do that in all of those places like Syria right now or neighboring places where Syrian refugees are, we try and build in elements of recovery for the community really quickly. So for them to be able to regroup, recover from whatever shock that they're facing, build up their capacity to bear that shock a little bit better the next time and the next time. So helping on the path to what is, I get a little overused, but to be more resilient to oncoming shocks. And I think that's what bears out with our 30 years nearly of, well, actually over 30 years now, of work in Afghanistan, that all of our programming there has moved away from any type of response to systems level issues. So we are really working with, in this country, so let's draw the picture of Afghanistan a little bit. Nearly 30, 32 million population, about 75% of that is under the age of 25. So imagine that for a second, right? And you saw how expansive that is. So there are population bases and then it's just spread out. 34 provinces, most of them are in some kind of civil war state. So the centers of the provinces are under government control, other than for a period Kunduz was taken over by the Taliban. But outside the center, the provincial capitals, it's either Taliban or now starting to be ISIS or some warlord or some other faction. There's just so many factions that you start mapping them out that are in control. So a country that is still pretty much in turmoil after the it's pretty well laid out in the article that you read. Unemployment between 35% to 85%, and there's a lot of hidden unemployment that doesn't even get counted. When you go into water resources, there's a photograph that's taken from an airplane and doesn't make any sense because it's tilted, which shows the what they call the Registan, the desert, as it just is complete desert. And I've heard from them that it goes all the way towards the Arabian Peninsula. I mean, it's that kind of desert. Desertification is a major issue in Afghanistan. Water resources are scarce, and that's another area that we are working with communities on social water management, especially around irrigation, because that ties in with the agricultural theme that we have been working with. Only 25% of the households are on the electric grid, are connected to the grid. And even that grid is not reliable. So when people see lights on those lights, like, oh, that's working. You know, I mean, that's something to comment on, not to just take. So it gives you a little bit of a sense of what's brewing in the country. With this context, we are working on, especially in the south and the northeast, in various provinces, on water management, as I said, on agricultural, all the way from new techniques that hopefully one day could become a viable alternative for poppy, though poppy cultivation has been on the rise this past year. We are specifically focusing on high-value crops like pistachios and saffron, for instance, that can compare in terms of price somewhat to poppy, potentially, especially for those people who want to see an alternative that they want to move towards. And we're working in partnership with universities, trying to not just do a project around it, but to really change the syllabus that's being put out by agricultural universities. So illiteracy is high amongst farmers. And previously, when new techniques for growing something would come out, they'd be so heavily written. You know, there's just so much theory that an illiterate person is going to think it's a joke. So what we've been working on is producing manuals for cultivating these new crops that are less familiar, especially the varieties that we are introducing in complete like graphic form, so keeping the population literacy in mind. We are working especially with youth, given the huge youth population we have, building their skills with a path to employment. In Helmand and Kandahar, in the last 7 to 8 years, we worked with around 30,000 youth, 30% of them women. This is Taliban heartland. Taliban came out of Kandahar and have a huge presence in Helmand. And to be able to work with women on vocational and technical skills was a major achievement. It was actually the community's trust that made it possible. Okay, I'm gonna speed it up, sorry. I'm just excited about this topic. So youth skills, and then we are also working on solar energy as an alternative for all those people who are not on the grid. And that hasn't really taken off, but we are hoping that it would soon. In Pakistan too, we've been working since 1986. From 86 to 2001, it was all about Afghan refugees. That was the only thing we focused on. In 2002, we finally started working with Pakistani populations. Pakistan, by contrast, a country of 200 million, nearly the same size as Afghanistan, maybe a little smaller. 200 million, I think the sixth largest population in the world, the 26th biggest economy, and 147th in the Human Development Index. Both Pakistan and Afghanistan are, according to Transparency International and being there, one of the biggest banes of their existence is governance and corruption. They are fairly high on the corruption indices. And I was surprised that didn't come out more in the article that you read, but that is undercutting a lot of what's going on in both countries, really. So in Pakistan, one of our flagships is public health programming. This immense population of people, which has some really rich people, the rich are so rich, but the middle class is really small. And so you're either really poor or you're really rich. Mostly you're really poor. Has the fifth highest burden of tuberculosis in the world, the sixth highest burden of maternal child health still in the world. And as a result, we're very focused on public health. We, in both countries in the last year, we're also doing, in Pakistan, because it's a repeating cycle of earthquakes and flooding, the flooding of 2010 affected 20 million people. That's like bigger than some countries getting impacted. And I'm sure you've heard about the massive earthquakes that the country faces on a repeating cycle. So we respond to those as well and work around them. Econ and youth are two other focus areas that we've been working with. And some of those photographs would show you the kinds of activities that have been going on. And as was our roots, we've been working with Afghan refugees in Pakistan for a long time. The issue that's emerging right now for us is return migration. So Pakistan has set a deadline for March 31st for refugees to return to Afghanistan. Now, right after 2001, Pakistan and UNHCR, at that time hosting around 3 million estimated population of Afghans in Pakistan, many of whom have been there for 30 to 40 years nearly now. So second generation, third generation, some have never even gone back to Afghanistan. They were born there, they were raised there, are now under a deadline of March 31st to return to Afghanistan. And keep in mind, the population of Afghanistan, the last census was done in 1979, so all we work off of is estimates, is anywhere between 30 and 32 million. So Pakistan has 1.5 million registered refugees, and then supposedly more than 1 million to 2 million unregistered refugees from Afghanistan. Iran has around a million registered. And there's pressure now for those who had gone on the trek towards Europe after Angela Merkel's speech. They're coming back, they're being sent back. Pakistan is sending them back, Iran is sending them back. This past year, over 600,000 people returned to Afghanistan, a place which you can imagine doesn't have the services in place for the population it does have. And then all of those who are returning don't have those networks in place either. So, and we have been working with refugee returns for a long time. But what has happened is that refugees would go from either from Iran or from Pakistan back to Afghanistan for a short period of time, or send one family member who would just go and suss out the water, and then they would either come back or go elsewhere. And that seasonal migration has been kind of the norm for a long time now. But what we're seeing now in Pakistan especially is that the communities that were predominantly Afghan refugees, the housing prices there are crashing because they're selling off property and returning because there's this much pressure from the government. The government of Pakistan has tied this return deadline to a national security objective. So now it's the military who's sort of at the forefront of this. Since 2002, UNHCR and Pakistan government were working on a returns program, but that was voluntary. So for us, this is the latest emerging challenge that we are facing of how do you, within the conditions that are available to you, try and cater to the needs of, the estimates are about 1.5 to 2 million returning people to a country that doesn't have the wherewithal right now to even sustain what it does have in terms of population. To give you a sense of what the issues we face is that in Kandahar, we are working with youth on various technical skills, and some of them are super interesting. I was talking to them, and the latest one that they're really interested in learning is how to work with solar power, you know, maintenance of all of these solar panels that are emerging all over the place, a country that doesn't have an electric grid that serves you, so you look for alternatives. But the problem is that the market is shrinking. And we are trying really hard to see, okay, how do you do import substitution? But everything has other, you know, it's almost like a dominoes effect. So if you touch this, it hits this and it hits that. But we're trying to see how we can partner maybe with the construction industry and with the garments industry and focus on those specific things and start tracking more lower scale labor towards that size and work on that. But market absorption is an issue with nascent markets, something that we're dealing with. I think I'm at the 30-minute mark. I can keep on talking for a long time, but I think it might be a good place to maybe start taking in questions. Would that work?
I can walk around the mic if anyone's got a question.
How do the men accept you in Afghanistan and Pakistan as a woman trying to lead them?
Thank you for that question. I'm a pretty okay person to deal with. I'm kidding. They have been very, very gracious. They've been extremely gracious. And there's just so many... The teams that we're working with, you know, as the global director for Mercy Corps these last 5 years, I traveled quite frequently to various parts of where we work, from Africa to Middle East, to Asia, Central, you know, all of these places. And the teams that we have in place in Afghanistan and Pakistan, I can very honestly say are some of our most amazing stories behind each one of them. And they are in this business because they really care about it. And they work with female colleagues outside of me. And some of the women from those parts of the world are really strong women. I mean, you kind of have to be to make your way into something like that. You know, otherwise, there's so many things standing in your way that you have to fight through it all. So, I usually make sure that I'm not stepping on anyone's toes, as well as being very conscious of they're on the ground, they know what they're dealing with. I haven't had a problem yet at all. The concern that we were thinking of when I was moving into this role and had a very interesting conversation with our CEO as well was being a Pakistani origin person. I've been now an Oregonian nearly 20 years. And going into Afghanistan, Pakistan and Afghanistan, as you would have read, have a very much a hate-hate relationship going on. And I was concerned about that and how that would unfold. But even in the communities, most people will look at me and say Pakistani, and then would start speaking in Urdu, and like tell stories of I was in Peshawar for 15 years, or I was in Quetta. So I think civilian to civilian interaction is like any place. People work out really well when it depends on who you are, how you're behaving, and how the other person reacts to you. It's the governments that really are clashing for sure. Did I answer your question?
I can't say his name, but the Montana-based who had the school going on in Afghanistan, they got all the flack about not using the money right. Is he still there working? Greg Mortensen, I couldn't say his name.
I haven't come across anything related to him recently, so I don't know the answer, but haven't come across anything.
Okay, yeah. Thank you.
School's question, what's the... what's the compare and contrast between schooling in Afghanistan and Pakistan for young women? Are you dealing with similar challenges? Is there greater opportunity in one place versus the other?
That's an excellent question. It really depends where you are, which part. So there's in the cities of Pakistan or in Kabul or in Herat, you'd have excellent opportunities for education in Pakistan. Private education really has taken off in the last decade or two, so a lot of private schools that parents prefer to send their children to, especially both boys and girls, really. But in overarching comparison, Afghanistan has more issues with staff across the board and paying salaries and teachers. But as I was saying, going to the north, you know, I was thinking we'll have really bad conditions, but really dedicated teachers, really dedicated principals. So there's this principal, he's got like a beard going from here to here, and would not even look at me when talking to me, and this is 2004, but He wanted to have soccer available for the girls in his school. So this was a girls' school in Talukan, in Takhar province. And you know, everything he was saying, and I was just looking at him, I was like, you look at somebody and you kind of make this assumption that they must think this way because they're dressed a certain way or look a certain way. But no, I mean, he was all about bringing the girls into the century with everything that could be brought for them. So yes, Afghanistan has lesser services available, for sure. And that's a concern too, for especially those girls who grew up in Pakistan, maybe with more mobility. And if they're coming to rural areas, they will face challenges in how they resettle over there. Yes, please. Morality, that's such an interesting question and so broad. I'm trying to. The question is, when I say corruption, does it mean the same thing over there that it does here? And what is their moral compass? What does morality mean over there? Wow. Does anyone want to take that question? let me talk personally. So, and let me use Pakistan because I think that, you know, easier to speak of your own people. When I was a child, and we would just hear conversations going on about this family or that family, or especially when people were matchmaking and, you know, trying to arrange some kind of a marriage between two families. And the word they would use was Sharif, which is kind of like, what is their morality? You know, are they good people? Are they honest people? Are they educated? Are they earning an honest living? So it's a word that encapsulates a lot. And what I've noticed over the years, especially while I've been gone and going back, is hardly anyone uses that term anymore. They say, how much money do they have? And they don't even ask where that money is coming from. People were so focused at one time. Pakistan was a post, you know, like there were a lot of immigrants that had come in from India, what used to be United Pakistan and India. So it was a country that was making itself, and it's just 70 years old. So very, very young as a country. And there was a lot of focus on education because that was seen as the path to where it would take you next. And that has eroded a lot. And a lot of that has eroded, I personally believe, just you know, experiencing it as a result of what happened during the Soviet war in Afghanistan and Pakistan's role in it. There was a huge influx of armaments, of money, of opium-related money that came into the country, and people made a lot of money. Actually, there's a very interesting reading if you want to go through an audit report that came out. SIGAR is the Special Inspector General's Office of the United States, and they are focused on auditing all of U.S. government. They're part of the U.S. government, and they also audit U.S. government operations in Afghanistan. And what they came up with their report at the 15th anniversary of the war, and I don't remember exact data, but they were looking at about $115 billion worth of investment in Afghanistan over these past 15 years. And one of the things they called out is how much corruption really just took off during these years, because there was money flooding into the country, unprecedented. And that, if whether it created anything or not, it definitely created amazing levels of corruption that had never been before seen in this country. So that's a fascinating report to read. And morality in the, so I think pretty comparable to what you would call morality over here. I mean, across the world, wherever I go, it's the same things. You know, be good to people around you. Don't usurp anyone else's rights. And I think it comes from those major Abrahamic religions, really, where the roots are of that morality being driven from. So I think fairly comparable, yeah.
Is it coming? Okay. Back to the education question. It's a question that really concerns me in our country as well as what's going on in other places, is the fact that private schools and charter schools are now dominating, And what I worry about is what happens to those kids who are left in the other schools. They've taken away the parents who used to fight for things because they've now put them in another school. And it's not like they shouldn't have a choice, but I think it's a big concern. Is it a concern over there too?
It is definitely a big concern. And how funding is distributed between urban centers and how far it goes from outside of your constituency, whatever it might be, is definitely another issue. So again, speaking to Pakistan, where I grew up, I went to both a public school and a private school. I went to a convent school where most of my family, my mother's side of the family, had gone to just because it was the best school in our neighborhood. And it was an amazing experience, and moving from that to a public school, which was a really well-funded public school in the capital city. So, but there was differences. It had a library, maybe six times the library that was in the convent, but you couldn't access anything. They were behind glass doors, and that was the first time I sent my dad to the PTA, and that was the start of a constant open door thing for him. I was like, I can't deal with this. I mean, every day I'd come home and say, they have huge amount of this, but we can't touch it. What's the point of this? So there's so many shades of the issue, but I think that has been a concern and continues to be a concern. But on the other side of it, the massive population also makes it kind of necessary for those public schools to work, because parents have an opinion, whether they have the money or not, they will come and say, why aren't they getting an education? But that question, when you dig deeper into it, and when you really get into the poverty angle, is what caused, I would say, almost where we are with the madrasa system now. So the madrasas, which really expanded massively. Madrasa is a term for school in Urdu. But madrasa, the word, is used for mostly now schools that are most focused on Islamic education as the core of it, rather than the education that is board certified that all Pakistani schools must require in terms of you passing board examinations, a central system of examinations, of certification. And it was during, again, the Soviet war in Afghanistan, where Saudi money, US money was coming in, and the whole idea of madrasas, especially Saudi-funded madrasas, started coming up. And now you go around the country, and I've traveled quite a bit, and it's amazing how many madrasas you see. And they usually have boarding with it. And that started becoming a feeding line I'm not going to speak to any specific madrasa, but that started becoming a feeding line in for the Taliban as well. Because there was this really interesting movie that was done a few years ago called The Children of Taliban, if you have a chance to watch it. It's well done. And what's happening is people who couldn't really, had six or seven children, couldn't really afford to feed them, give them an education, would say, okay, well, at least the madrasa would teach them how to read, even if it's the Quran, and not even if it's the Quran, but they'll learn something about their religion, and we don't have the capacity to do that. If it's a boarding one, then they get taken care of completely. And from there, it just goes, it's a slippery slope. So there's so many angles to education, and education is at the core of it. If governance, for me, is like a top issue for both Afghanistan and Pakistan, along with corruption, education comes in a close second, because without that, people don't ever ask. Right. Exactly. Exactly. Yeah. The kind of education also changes. So what also was the difference was, if you don't exactly answer the question the way the teacher told you to answer it, you don't get marks for it. And that was another issue. And it was major debate time.
I don't hear too well, so you might have covered this and I missed it, but I just wanted to ask you, what is being done about family planning over there in this very crowded country?
In Pakistan?
Pakistan or Afghanistan.
Yeah, lots of efforts, and lots of efforts in Pakistan, because, population explosion, really, in that country. And a lot of effort to make sure that it seemed to be within Islamic constraints, so, and the women's movement itself in Pakistan has been doing a lot of work to bring both those sides together. So the mullah from a mosque wouldn't be able to say, well, it's an un-Islamic to plan a family. There has been a lot of effort over the years. I am not so familiar with what the efforts are in Afghanistan as a population base. It's not as big compared to what Pakistan has. So I could come back to you with more information on that. It's not an area that we've been very active, so I'm not very familiar with that. In Pakistan, do you mean? Yeah, there is national family planning programs. There are programs that are being supported by international organizations that have been very active, from the UN system to grants from US government to European, like a lot of different sources, but definitely forefront the government itself.
Good afternoon. What determines how much of a woman's face is covered by fabric, all the way up to the eyes as opposed to the entire face?
They're very cool question. So there are a couple of pictures over there. In Kabul, when I am, you're asking about Afghanistan right now, or both countries? Both countries. In Afghanistan, in Kabul, I would put this over my head, and that's fine. You know, I've got clothes that are going to about here, and I'm mostly being driven around. If I'm walking around, I might take something a little bit more that covers me, but the face doesn't need to be covered. I'm fine without that. As we were traveling, and some of those photographs are of me and my colleague traveling from Kabul to Kandahar. So to then go to the airport, we put in what you will see as the black niqab and hijab with the abaya. That was appropriate for the airplane that would land in Kandahar airport. To be then inside of Kandahar city, we then donned the ubiquitous slate gray burqa that just has that thing that you sort of, the mesh that you see through. And actually one of the photographs that might have made no sense was taken from behind the burqa to give a sense of your visibility when you're inside the burqa. I was just like, this is so interesting. I have like complete blinders. This was my first time wearing a burqa. In comparison, so there are places in central cities where you can be fine, depending on how much you'd be within people that you don't know, right? So if you're in a marketplace, you'd cover up a bit more, even in a city. If you're just being driven around, you just put something over your head, and that's respectful enough. In the rural areas, especially in the south or even in the north, you cover up quite a bit. And for us, it's also a security measure. So if we don't stand out in some way, you don't attract attention to yourself. So for me, going out to, even outside of Kandahar city, into the districts, the team members who were with me, they were saying, okay, from here on, no English. So you speak either Urdu or Dari or whatever Pashto you know. So it depends. In Pakistan, it used to be extremely family driven. And I should say in Afghanistan too, there was a time before all of this started where, you know, I mean, it was pretty much like the cities could be comparable to Europe. I mean, you wore whatever you wore, whichever your family was comfortable with. You could be in skirts and in sleeveless clothes, or you could be more conservatively dressed, depending on family norms, mostly. And that was also true of Pakistan, of my mother's generation. So I see all these photographs of them, and they're wearing bell bottoms and these little tiny shirts and sleeveless stuff and saris with, you know, so all kinds of things meant. And then Zia-ul-Haq became our president, and for the most part of my life, I only knew him as the president, and this was during the war that had started with Afghanistan. And he stayed president for 11 years. He was the commander-in-chief of the army before that. And his whole thing was, I'm here for Islam. And it became a state-run thing on how you dressed. A good woman dressed a certain way. And the space for expression based on how your family thought became a little less. But since then, it's sort of changed again. So in Islamabad, Lahore, Karachi, the major centers, you'd see girls in jeans and skirts and all of that, as well as shalwar kameez, what I'm wearing. I would wear this over there. If I'm going into a more conservative area, out of respect, I would cover my head. If I am going to a really conservative part of the country, I might take this, open up the chadar completely, and I think you might have seen that, and just put it over my head and cover myself up. That was my first time wearing a burqa ever, and I grew up in Pakistan, so if that gives you... Yes, please.
I'm sorry. So my question for you is, most humanitarian organizations, one of their first concerns is clean water to rural and urban areas. You mentioned clean water and water management quite a bit, and I was wondering if there's any noticeable strides in water management and irrigation science and your work with farmers, communities, and who are your biggest support centers for that, and if you could just talk more about that.
Yeah, we are in Afghanistan working very closely with the government departments around water. What we have had luck with most recently in the last few years is using a remote platform for data of how water is being managed. So the issues around water management become incendiary pretty quickly because it's livelihoods, right? And it's a scarce resource, and it is the means to your income and to your whole family survival. And water gets cut, it results in major fighting, even sometimes it can escalate pretty quickly. So working with water users associations, which are pretty common in the rest of the world, but in Afghanistan, there's still the mihrab system where you moving away from that has taken a while. And now, especially the areas where we are working, we are bringing community members together on a more, beyond the one person, on a more representative manner. And not just giving them the ability to come together and decide on things, but the data on how water is being used. And that is proving, those two things coming together is proving to be pretty phenomenal. So when they can access how much water is going to whom, and everybody can see, and it's not being contested, that becomes real. And they're working with real data, real time, without having to all the time go back and check for themselves, doing some SWOT checks, you know, and all of that in place. That's been fairly phenomenal in moving people more towards that.
I just wanted to add,
yes,
it is the family or the husband who really dictates how a woman dresses in Pakistan. And so you have a broad range of dress.
Right.
And sometimes the government, as under Zia, says stuff and you have to dress that way.
Right.
Pakistan has become much more conservative, is more conservative now than it was 10 years ago in terms of the dress of the women.
I would say...
Pakistani women have said.
Right. I would say pre-Zia years, the 70s, before he took power, was a completely different story of... it was exactly your family was what you had to deal with and what you wore or how you wore it. The post-Zia years, we've started seeing it again. You know, I look at my niece and nephew and they're wearing what I'm wearing in the U.S. So the clothes, they don't have to do shopping to come here. And that's... Yeah, so it's come back over after Zia went off.
What do the, say, the Taliban, whatever they may be in Afghanistan, and then the TTP, whatever they are in Pakistan, what do they think about your activities that are helping poor people? You know, is that a challenge to them? Do they accept you, or are you feel danger from them?
Yeah. So as I was mentioning, we kept on working through the, in Afghanistan, we were operational throughout the years that the Taliban had the, were running the government, and we have continued to work in Helmand and Kandahar, which are again Taliban heartland areas. And the reason is because our team who's working there is from that community. And I think the other reason is, which is the core of our security management, is acceptance by the community. So if they don't feel like we're doing what they need, it's not benefiting the community, then we're not going to be there. So when it's a moment, and in other places too, when it's come to a question of somebody coming in and questioning and saying, what are you doing here? It's hardly ever we who speak up for ourselves, it's the community who speaks up and says, this is what they're doing and they're helping us. Okay, sure. And so there have been an incident or two where our team members were stopped along a major artery road and expressed who they were and then were let go because of the affiliation. And I don't think that's because of the brand worldwide. It's really because of what's going on in those communities and working so closely with members there. And I think the value comes from, the security also comes from that. Is that what you were asking, or were you going a different?
So you're basically protected by the local community.
Yeah, yeah. If they don't want us there, there's no way that we can be there. They have to see value in it.
We are out of time. let us give Najia a big hand. Just a reminder, we'll be in here for the remainder of the series. Next week is on the future of Europe. And for the interest of clarity, we are videotaping this, we are live streaming this, so if you have a question or a comment, it needs to be on a mic, so I will always be walking around with this. If you raise your hand and yell out, it won't do anyone any good because they won't hear it and you won't hear it either. So, the question was, if somebody misses one of these, we will be putting video actually up on our website, usually about a week or so after each episode.